I would like to introduce you Professor Maya Dimitrova. She is from the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences and Institute of Robotics. This is the top institution in Bulgaria on robotics. Professor Maya Dimitrova received her master's in psychology with distinction from St. Petersburg University in Russia in 1985. Her master's also in psychology by research, also with distinction from Warwick University, United Kingdom in 1995. And her PhD in application of principles of methods of cybernetics in different areas of science from the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences in 2002. Since 2007, she is an associate professor at the Department of the Institute of Robotics at the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences. She was a coordinator of two nationally funded projects in Bulgaria and has won twice Japan, what is JPS?
Japan Society for Promotion of Science.
Okay, Japan Society for Promotion of Sciences grants for research in Japan 2006 and 2015. So, Professor Dimitrova, she has experience with Japanese on robotics. Her research interests are in cognitive and social robotics, human-robot interaction, cyber-physical systems for special education, neural networks. She participated actively in UCOG, that's a European network, 2012-2014, and currently you call European Association for Cognitive Systems. That's where I met her, in this network, in Bochum, Germany. She's a reviewer for the International Journal of Humanoid Robotics, Lovotics, Frontiers in Psychology, International Journal of Web-based Learning and Teaching Technology. I would like to say that Bulgaria is a nearby, is a neighbor, and we have opportunities, we can do a lot of things in the context of the European Union. Currently, with Professor Dimitrova, we have submitted a proposal regarding robotics, intelligent robots, let's say. And she will tell you the rest.
Thank you. Hi colleagues, I'm really glad and excited to be here and to present some of our current work, a lot of which has been collaborated between my institute and MTech. And we are in the middle of some exciting developments, and we would like to continue working on that. I will tell you later about the proposal we submitted recently, and no matter what the decision of the reviewers will be, we will improve, move on, and continue our collaboration, hopefully, because we have many shared, common shared ideas, and also we can complement each other. And I'm probably the only person in Bulgaria who graduated in psychology, but then she moved to engineering. So I am proud to say that I'm probably the only robot psychologist in Bulgaria, and which makes me very happy. Recently, a novel topic emerged in science, in engineering science, about design of cyber-physical systems. And I will tell you more about this in a minute, but the thing is that these cyber-physical systems, which are supposed to account for many levels, intelligent levels, within a system with lots of parts and components, including the human in the decision-making loop. Those systems will become the medium and our children will have to exist. So we try to forward the idea that the psychophysical system framework is very appropriate for education, because our children, who are going to be the workers and the scientists of the future, they need to know the complexity of technology from the very basics and from the very early age. Moreover, we all know how adept they are, how keen on this all children are. the problem with interdisciplinary research is that we dive into a huge amount of definitions. We need to spell out. In experimental psychology, there is a common consensus on whenever we research a phenomenon, we need to define operational definition and stick to the operational definition when discussing the manifestations of the phenomenon if we want to be precise in research. Otherwise, we can just discuss all aspects of the phenomenon from all points of view, psychological and philosophical and engineering and many and abstract logic and so on and so on. But if we are doing some particular research, we need to stick to the operational definition, which explains the main aspects which can be measured and compared in doing research on this particular phenomenon. So we can start with the definition of assistive robot. And some time ago, a nice definition was proposed by David Jaffe on assistive robots in general, and not just socially assistive robots. So assistive robot, according to him, is a device that can perceive and process perceptual information and perform activities that are beneficial to children or adults with special needs. So we focus on the learning needs. Not in general, mostly, but actually we deal with a wide range, not just learning, focusing on the learning, but also accounting for some related issues. Then the next definition is to go narrower. Socially, we can have a variety of assistive robots, not necessarily humanoid, but what would a socially assistive robot be or look like? And there is a definition, emphasizing the resemblance to a human by a robot. However, there is a separate line of research, and we can some other time discuss it, called the uncanny valley phenomenon, proving that people prefer this type of humanoid robots. Like now, but not this type of robots. It is based on the very human way of perceiving the reality, is that I feel confident with something that resembles the human on a generalized level, on a surface-based resemblance. So surface-based resemblance, we hate it. We do not accept it internally. Whereas the generalized level, the robot can communicate with me, and I feel very comfortable with this type of robot. And it can resemble a lot of human ways of communicating, yet not being resembles on a deep level, whereas on the surface level, we just hate this resemblance. And it can be proven experimentally. But then we go after socially assistive robots, let's go to educational assistive robots, and there are two aspects to this. Since education is a socially mediated process, there are varieties of possibilities to learn by myself, but I need to communicate my knowledge, what I've learned, or how I understand things. So it is always always a social process. There are two aspects. Can a robot explain to me what social education is? And on the other hand, can a robot explain to me in a social way what education is, or what we want to learn, or the subject we are learning? So we must account for both and not confuse both aspects. What is the difference between an educational assistive robot and a pedagogical assistive robot? Then in educational assistive robots, they have been around for many years, and they assist the learning process. They assist our learning strategy in one-to-one interaction configuration. The robot interacts with the learner interacts with the robot. Whereas pedagogical assistant robots, this is what we propose together. So it's within our common framework is to introduce robots as assistants to the teacher. The teacher needs an assistant, and instead of a human, you can use a robot and make the most of this by using the complementary aspects of human and a robot. Because a human and a human can clash, a robot and a robot can clash in their strategies. But the human can make the most of the robot, and the robot can be a social mediator between the learner and the teacher. And the rest of the talk for the first part is devoted to this aspect, how a robot can be the mediator in the social process of learning. The focus, if we want to model something and we take the overlap between different disciplines, then it goes stuck in a much more complicated way. And here we see how complex the problem of designing such a cyber physical system is. It takes overlaps of sciences and also overlap on top. And here, the educational assistant robot, which is one-to-one with a learner and a robot, and pedagogical assistant robot, which is a triple configuration in a cyber-physical system framework, relate to network robotics, educational sciences and networks, social sciences and networks. They deal with learning sciences based on brain studies and approaches to designing learning strategies in educational settings, as well as social communication, also in relation to robotics. The social robots idea has been around for a couple of decades. So, Kirsten Dottendam outlined five functional roles of social robots, which we can use or refer to. If we see a robot, we can say that this is a social robot. It has nothing to do with appearance. Sometimes it can look like a human or not, or look like an animal, or just abstract, like in the movies. But it has to be a social robot. It has to be socially evocative, socially situated, sociable, socially intelligent, and socially interact. So we focus here. We focus on social interactive. And the nice thing about the robot, for humans, a socially interactive person must be socially intelligent. But within a robot, you can split both things as a programming issue. So you can make it socially interactive, supporting the teacher, without having whatsoever idea what the social intelligence is from a robotic point of view. And this is a nice thing. This is how we can make use of this robotic technology. Whereas socially evocative, socially situated, and sociable, it means how a human perceives the robot. It's only subjective feeling. Here we have objective processes model, and we can focus from a computational intelligence point of view, how to model these particular aspects and focuses on the social intelligence of human and also using making use of the social interaction, the ability for social interaction from robot without being whatsoever social intelligent.
Main behaviors of a social robot, according to the same author, according to her, it is that they can perform the following behaviors. These robots can express and perceive emotions, communicate with high-level dialogue, learn models of or recognize other agents, establish or maintain social relations, use natural cues, gaze, gestures, etc., exhibit distinctive personality and character, and may learn or develop social competencies. Here, we focus on these two, developing social competence. It means that the cyber-physical system at some level will have a module accounting for the socially intelligent behavior. This is one of the aspects. It's not inside the robot. And using natural gaze, this is inside the robot. By using natural cues, the robot will help me feel more comfortable with him, even share my secrets. And then, how would a learner perceive the robot as a teacher? And now, was presenting a zoology lesson to students. We wanted to see the students, although the direction in the future is about special education, but here we wanted to see what learners, engineering sciences, what their ideal behavior would be while listening to our lesson presented by a humanoid robot. So, the robot was explaining was giving some information about sea animals and also about forest animals. And we used to wear glasses. So, a general definition of cognitive biometrics, a nice one, is proposed by Kenneth Revitt. That the stimuli are designed to elicit responses that are sensitive to the individual's genetic predispositions, modulated by subjective experiences. For example, the way a person looks at fractals. One person looks at fractals in a way absolutely different from the way another person looks at fractals. So it is very important how you design the stimulus. In our case, the stimulus is our humanoid robot now. Researchers explain how persons' gaits, their tiny but rapid involuntary eye movements, can be measured using a video camera. We are not working with circades because it's too. We just work with gaze direction because the circades is difficult to capture and process in our setting. The pattern of the gaze is as unique as an iris or fingerprint scan, but easier to record, and so could provide an alternative secure biometric identification technology. In special schools, this is extremely helpful because children don't like to be tortured with glasses and some other devices to be measured and so on and so on. So this remote, distance-based way of identifying the person with biometric techniques is very, very valuable. In this particular study, the interesting aspect of the study was the connecting link between cognitive and social motivation as measured in one experiment. We introduced a post-study questionnaire. Immediately after, it took about 5-6 minutes, I think, the whole session. Immediately after the session, a questionnaire was delivered to the participants. It consisted of three bullet points. Unexpected three recall tests. How many features do you remember presented by the robot regarding the sea animals, and how many features you remember presented by the robot about the forest animals? And the level of recall was portrait. The information was very simple, but they just did not assume this was the main point of the study. And which is surprising because the information was really simple. A question, if they have comments about now as a robot teacher, this was one of the one we cared about, and they had to type down any assumption they had. For example, I enjoyed the way now presented the lesson. Or the voice of the robot was too artificial. The presentation was very slow. The robot must behave in a more natural way. These kind of assumptions, we collected them and we coded them as two types: positive comments on the robot and recommendations. So if they say the speed is too slow, we assume that they recommend that we make it faster. So, two possible, the comments were split in two groups. Positive comments on the robot and the entire session, and recommendation on robot behavior. Then, and finally, we asked one social motivation question like the following. There were two persons and a robot. The robot delivering lesson. And we asked them, did you feel it better to have appear somebody else with you while listening to a robot teacher, or if you were just indifferent? It didn't matter for you if you are alone in the room with the robot or with some other people. And according to their answers, we also split the group of participants in two groups, socially motivated and socially indifferent learners. Context of the main hypothesis of this study. We focus on using natural cues to study social competencies in introducing the robot as a pedagogical assistant in the classroom. The proposed framework is intended for both difficult children and children with specific difficulties. And in some cases, even this the kind of difficulties which are having social barriers between the student and the teacher, like, for example, in autism. There is one interesting theory, which, because there is a discussion on which comes first, based on brain studies, which comes first, social interaction or social intervention. In fact, because it's an educational system, in general, schools from ancient time, from Aristotle time, are being quite conservative in their approach. So the teaching goes like, I explain to the student what a social cue would mean if somebody wants to talk to me, they will look at me and smile and so on and so on. And if they frown, they don't want to talk. If they turn their eyes, they don't want to talk to me. But if they approach me, they want to talk to me. And things like that. So this is social observation. We make the learner observe the others, the social behavior of the others, draw some conclusions, and then start interacting with them. Social interaction. And for this, we had two neural systems. One is called mirror neural system, and it's responsible for empathy, recently discovered, by the way. In a very interesting, I think I have an alternative story how they discovered the mirror neural system around 10 years ago, or 15. And there is this logical, to the left, logical system of social observation, making conclusions, what I observe, in order to start interacting, in order to implement my knowledge into my action. And Schubach, in his laboratory, they say, they try to prove that they are different. They just put social observation, social interaction are different processes located in different areas of the brain. However, with some phenomena which could not be explained by traditional physics. The discovery of the mirror neural system. By the way, do you know what the mirror neural system is? Raise your hand. Have you read about that?
Yeah.
Christina, you can. Yeah, please, anyone else?
Neural system?
Mirror.
Mirror.
So, Christina knows, Nikki knows, and the sixth. mirror neural system. So, it was some people who got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of the mirror neural system. It was assumed that all brain areas and types of brain cells have been discovered 100 years ago. It was assumed like this. So they wanted to. There is also an approach to learn how one single neuron performs, and we at the network, we listened a lot to those lectures by Ridulati and others on it turns out that a mirror, it used to be, we have perception neurons and action neurons, and a perception neuron fires when I perceive something and send signal to the action neuron, and the action neuron performs my grasp. So I see a banana, and then I catch the banana. It used to be like this in Pavlov Eva, physiology of the brain. But nobody believed that at the verge of the 21st century you can discover a another type of signal encoding in the brain, like mirror neuron. Mirror, it's mirror, I watch in the mirror, I see myself in the mirror, and the neuron. So the neuron system which performs in a similar way, like I see myself in the mirror. They were trying, but then it turned out, but then it turned out that the relation between perception neuron and a perception neuron and an action neuron is that simple, that there are some very complex going back and so on connections. So we're not discussing this at the moment. But as a group of neurons, there is a group of neurons of this type, which near to the executive, some executive areas, I in Japan, I went to the lesson of this person who was telling how they discovered this, they tried to measure some motor response in some sensor area, and nothing came out of the experiment. And he was all mad at himself, the researcher, and the poor monkey, which was with these electrodes, was also very miserable. And the researcher grabbed the banana and started eating it. And then the activation flashed in the monitor. The monkey observing the researcher eating the banana had in the motor area of the monkey brain, there was a flash of sensory information. The monkey reacted as if she was eating the banana when observing the researcher eating the banana. And this is the mirror neural system, and this is where empathy comes from. It means that if I saw you eating a lemon, I have my mouth full of water. It means that, and it flashes, this is the place it's responsible for this process. Before that, they thought it's an abstraction. But now they know that the motor response of my brain flashes when I do not perform a motion. It flashes when somebody else does it. And this was
it's at the beginning of the 21st century. This is a mirror neural system, but the funniest thing was how it was discovered. So, let's go back to what the difference between social observation and social interaction is. So, so when they discovered the place, the location of empathy in the brain, they started designing a huge amount of novel theories on how people perceive other people, how they react, how they co-feel about each other, and so on and so on. So it all of a sudden, this cognitive bulk, the brain, the cognitive thing, which was assumed that it will make some inferences about social behavior. So social is abstraction, cognitive is there, is objective, existing. The cognitive makes some conclusions about social things and then starts performing that. It turns out that there is a social area of the brain which directly perceives social stimuli and directly responds to social stimuli without, with or without being aware of this, making it coming to the consciousness, understanding, describing, explaining, and so on and so on and so on. And this is how I feel. I mean, it's extremely hard for us to explain, for me, to explain my social attitude, right? It's so difficult to logically explain to somebody else. But my attitude is there, and it is present. So the brain turns out to be a social matter, physical matter, which is social in nature, not just biological, not just. So Schilbach performed a very nice second experiment. And they went on, as I said, in various places in the world, in so many places in the world, they went on doing some of those experiments about the social interaction. Based measuring mirror neuron responses in all possible direct and indirect ways of registration of this activation. And here in Germany, there is a laboratory, they invite you, you go into the fMRI scanner, they get the imaging of your brain activities, and in cases when you have to perform a cognitive task. For example, I lie in this scanner and they project to me the eye movements of somebody else. Somebody's looking there, and my automatic reaction, and they measure my automatic reaction and also to see where the activation will be. And it was interesting because if you move your eyes and I follow your gaze spontaneous without any intention, just follow it. The mirror neural system flashes, it gets activated, and it is considered that the mentalizing system, the logical system, will flash if I start reasoning about something, but not if I perceive. And if I follow your eye gaze, my mirror neural system flashes. What they did is, this is an avatar. The avatar moves their eyes, and I follow his gaze. But if the avatar, without me knowing this, the avatar follows my gaze movements, I don't know that what the avatar does is me going there, looking here and there. It turns out the mentalizing system, the logical system, for some reason starts flashing spontaneously, like the mirror neurons. It turns out that things are much more complicated. It should flash only when I explicitly explain something, but no, it reacts. In the case, if I follow my case, things are being created. They probably are, it's a phenomenon not explained yet by some theories, and many attempt. This is our explanation. This is how we perceive this. So we assume that social observation is a process developing on top of the interaction. So it's a three-dimensional structure. The interaction is broad. I developed via interacting with my mother, with my, so it's a very early process. When you're on the bus or having a walk, please take a look at children, very little children. They maintain eye contact with strangers, immediate eye contact, and they also control you. They smile or they grab you. This is such an early process. It's also social observation, explicit social cognition. When I understand, I can formulate what exactly I feel about socializing. It's some central process. So this process manifested here is actually broader. So this is broader, and this one that comes on top of the first one. And then if this is a dimension, mathematical dimension, on the one end, it's probably jointed automatic behaviors, attention, moving towards slower processes, gaze-based social interaction. Here is my intentional gaze behavior, and here is my automatic gaze behavior. So in the classroom, this is always present. I mean, teachers, why do we need teachers? Because teachers, they get very skilled in this gaze-based social interaction. They look in the audience, capture their eyes. They know when the audience is tired. They make strategies, and they keep dragging you back here and, you know, dragging you into the lesson, into the knowledge. Whereas joint attention is, I move something and everybody follows and looks what happened. So the joint attention is what you drag from the audience. So here is the orientation, and here is your automatic reaction to what's going on. The attention focus is something. This is where your resource, cognitive resource, is inside, because cognitive processing requires a lot of energy, a lot of concentration, takes resource, and probably it could be that the mirror neuron system is probably closer to this end, to the automatic behavior. I see somebody eating banana, I all of a sudden I'm so angry. Then the mentalizing system is probably here where the intention lies in our model. These are the main results from the study. Let's go back to these are the hypothesis. This was the introduction, the hypothesis. Let's go back to the results of the studies. Sea animals, forest animals, 40%, 39%, very bad indeed. the mean items. So probably there are suggestions that maybe you have to explain to the listener, to the audience, to the students, that this is a lesson, although delivered by a robot, but you should focus on the knowledge, and so on and so on. And this is the main outcome of our study, the main statistically significant result we did not expect to obtain such kind of result. It turns out that people who said who liked the robot, they who gave positive comments. It turns out that the socially motivated, those who preferred the presence of somebody else, liked the robot more. Somebody would assume that if I'm indifferent to the presence of the others, I may like the robot more. And if I prefer the presence of humans, I will be more critical. But what we obtain is a completely opposite pattern, yet supporting the main assumptions of our model. The socially motivated people gave more positive comments and less recommendations, whereas the indifferent to the social presence people, they were very critical to the robot, which is very nice. And then we interpret this as a support to the socializing role of a humanoid robot in the classroom. It has, the humanoid robot has its place in the social media. It's better to use it in a social context rather than teacher a humanoid robot communicate with a person. So this is our claim.
So they were a typical student or with
typical.
Some?
No, typical. We did not take it to.
And this is, we wanted to see how in general the brain responds. Then we will see. So this is one of the, what I'm explaining is just ongoing research. I mean, nothing is, but at least we have some hints to move on. What are the implications of the finding that socially motivated participants gave more positive comments to the role of teacher than the socially different participants? This finding provides support to the hypothesis that social interaction is an essential and broader concept for education than making mere attempts from memorizing the contents of the lesson. With a human teacher, people are more attentive to the actual information presented in verbal and pictorial forms than with the robot. With the robot, they focus on the robot. With no tutoring, it seems that the participants focus on the entertaining and the communicative aspects of the human-robot interaction process than on the information which now is given by speaking and in pointing to pictures. And this is a question we should address in the future. So lights up. This is also found in the subjective reports after the session with Nao. And now, what are our further steps? If we want to translate to special education the implications of these results. So as I've already mentioned, please do this experiment. I do it in the underground. I sit in the underground and there is a baby across from me. Oh my god, it's such fun. It looks at me and then that's such a nice communication. Their mothers are surprised and so on and so on. So this is confirming the social interaction primacy, that everything starts with social interaction and knowledge develops on top of it. And a limited resource cost, and we for one a limited resource hypothesis. It states that whenever cognitive resource is limited, the cognitive system performs optimization. In this particular case, by attention focusing, which is an energy consuming process. If this optimization, if we have less resource, the cognitive system, the most intelligent, the human brain, the most intelligent design in the universe, performs optimization every time. Otherwise, it will just. What do we mean by this? And if we take autistic spectrum conditions, there is a way of looking at that and suggesting that they may be optimizing if the resource is limited, they may prefer to go deep into some mentalizing activity rather than to switch from this and this and this. Usually we process a lot of information simultaneously, for example thinking how to pay the rent. On top of it, I quarreled with my mother yesterday. On top of it, I'm listening to the lesson, and on top of it, I need to submit my report. So all these things are at one at the same time. But if the resource is limited, then we'll focus probably on the most important, so the most relevant, and so on and so on. So this is probably with what happens with these children. And the hypothesis is that those children go into this type of deep mentalizing activity because of the limited resource, and probably because this attention focus process is shifted. It's not broad, but it's shifted and less, so more focused. It means that a child would probably explicitly be aware of me, the child, of me being susceptible to those automatic influences, not being aware how much I can do with me using my gaze-based behavior. So if they are more aware of what little children do, to use my eyes, they avoid this communication. If they were somehow helped realize how powerful they can become if they include this type of cognitive behavior as well, rather than just go deep into what I want to do. Then we will have an effective therapeutic strategy. So in children with autism, gained by social interaction is being avoided. The area of awareness of my own social signaling is shifted towards the automatic range. I know that I can be influenced, and I don't know how I can influence the others. And being mainly aware of own automatic social signaling makes them shy or thinking it difficult to moderate behavior by conscious control. And the human-robot pedagogical strategy will focus on extending the attentional area towards demonstrating the easiness of one's own conscious modulation of eye signaling, shifting attention from focusing on the own automatic response to the social signaling of the others. This will lead to better adaptation of the robot tutor to the individual needs of the child. And the robot can help in this. In the future, we will probably try to confirm what we established already, that the participation of both social motivation and cognitive motivation in the process of perceiving a robot as a teacher was established and confirmed empirically. Further, this can be compared with the actual behavior of children with autism to see if this social motivation process is as influential as in the case of the typical university students by designing relevant game situations or scenarios. And this is, here we have two children, the teacher, and playing basketball with the robot now. And the nice thing in this particular situation is that they play turn-taking. One child makes the robot see the ball, hands to the other child. The other child places in the hand of the robot, and the robot throws it into the basket.
It has some consequences.
Yes. Yes, yes. Exactly. Yes, we did it. The main contribution so far, of our research, is an important relationship between the perception of a humanoid robot as a teacher and the social motivation of people is established experimentally. The positive attitude towards the robot is correlated with the human level of social motivation. This is a new phenomenon, and it's investigated in cooperation with scientists from the Institute of Technology of Kyushu, Japan, in 2015. This is a book I published, it's a very small book, on this theories before performing the experiments. And this is the Japanese one. In the second lecture, I'll tell you about our Bulgarian dog. So, the second part, it's about methodology. In interdisciplinary research, for example, the people doing the programming or the engineering. Engineering of the entire system. They are interested in how to make the system work. But then there are always some from the social sciences who would jump and say, how do you prove? How can you prove that what you've designed is what you wanted to design? How did you test your system? And especially if it is about education, and then how are you sure that this helps? And how are you sure that children can learn from that? And so on and so on and so on. It's a huge debate. So we performed one study and designed an approach, suggested an approach, how in general to test robotic scenario when you want to use them in special education. Here we focus on, it is more important, the testing of the system is more important when you talk about special education rather than just in education. And when you take the robot to school, then you may aim at some
expect some role of the robot in your learning, but you might just say that you can use the robot for fun, to attract interested children, and so on and so on. In special education, the role of the robot is a little bit more emphasized. It is supposed to help you make the children learn. We have recently finished one project of my institute, and in collaboration with a university in Norway and the Southwest University of Bulgaria on designing methodologies and technologies for enhancing the motor and social skills of children with disabilities. It is funded by the so-called Norway program of Norway. Norway, Liechtenstein and Iceland, they are within an organization called European Economic Area, EEA, which funds mostly funds projects which help disadvantaged people to get integrated in society, mostly in Eastern Europe, but also in Greece. Next year will be a call. And as far as I know, the loan has been bilateral, like Bulgaria, Norway, or Estonia, Iceland, but they suggest that next time they want to fund collaborative projects, like three countries proposing. So we may make use of this particular call together and submit the proposal to EEA. To this organization, and I think the funding is better than the European. There are the pluses and minuses, pros and cons. Here, what we had the nice combination of approaches. One was Kinect technologies for serious games, which Stavanger University is designing. And they're designing commercial games for people, if people want to buy Kinect-based games. You know, the Kinect-based games is when you play and on the screen you see some balls falling down and you catch them, so it's a virtual reality game. And Southwest University, the Department of Medical and Social Sciences, participated with specialists working with children and in two daycare centers. And they provided the profiles of children who were recruited to participate in our experiment. And our institute with the robot now and with the Kinect. Our approach combines two theoretical approaches, game theory and special education and control system theory, to propose novel educational technologies in a psychophysical. What we proposed was the so-called evolving design of games for children with special needs. It is traditionally how things work in this area is you design a set of games, scenario, test them in the pilot in the laboratory, and then test them in real life, and compare the results, make conclusions, submit a paper, and so on. But things become very difficult because the parameters you use, the metrics you introduce, they have huge standard deviations and you never get any conclusive results, and most of the results are descriptive. We wanted to introduce structure in a seemingly chaotic educational environment. What we did after piloting the test, the games in the laboratory and with children going to typical to standard schools, we took those games for experiment one in real life settings, then our approach suggests that we perform analysis and recommendations for improvement of the game, perform the game modifications, conduct experiment two, at least two real life experiments, and evaluate the change from experiment one to experiment two in quantitative terms. We need to find some number. What would the model look like? Also, a problem was with limited sample of participants. There are 15 games. We have 21 children, and children have different conditions, and they will play different games. But in two trials, it will not be easy to. Usually, then you have a group of participants playing a game, then going playing a set of games, then next time and next time and next time. Here, what we have is the ability to make the ability to use different numbers of games, different trials, and compare them in a systematic way so that this will not be crucial for the design of the situation. Let me give an example. One teacher works with several children. The children have a designated teacher, and this teacher is always with the child. So a teacher brings the child, and there are three scenes where the games can be performed, brings the child and plays game one. The important one is that the teacher would assess, would make the decision which of the set of games are appropriate for this particular child. Pick up one game, bring the child to play the game, and then take the child to play another game. And there is, in this situation, in our approach, another teacher will do the same, but we need not equalize number of games, symptoms, number of children. No, we have this framework. Teacher brings the child to play some games, and then we obtain the indicators, the parameters of our model to assess performance of the children. So every teacher gives scores to 9 criteria on a 5-point Likert scale, from -3 to +5 is -2 to +2. 0, -2, -1, 0, +1, +2. For example, after each of the game, after the child plays game number one, we ask the teacher, before moving to the second game, to fill in quickly, just to circle the number on a Likert scale, how relevant the game was for this child. -1, +1. How motivated was the child again to participate in this game? Does the game have impact on the cognitive development of the child? Actually, does it have potential to contribute? Can it contribute to the motor development of the child? Can it contribute to the social development of the child? Was the child interested in playing the game? What was the level of difficulty of the game? Was it important to play the game collectively? And is the game helpful for formation of new policies in school? For example, at first, this child going to standard school, a child can easily grasp the idea to make a puzzle with Kinect. With a child with special learning needs. It's not that intuitive for them. They need some explanation. They need to understand what the point is of this particular game. And just an explanation would not help, so we added a multimedia element, a sound, bang, whenever they make the right placement of the puzzle, there is a bang, and then they realize what the idea is, so the game becomes very easy for them to perform. This is new functionality. An example of YouTube, how to change, how to add a constructive element, was children very often carried around a favorite item, a favorite, it could be just a cube, a favorite toy. They felt more secure to carry around something and would not leave it aside to play with the robot. They always wanted. So the teacher said, can you make a platform? And they could place the favorite toy on the platform of the robot. So we added a constructive element, we changed the construction, and then it became easier for them to play by placing their favorite toys on the platform. And here is a scenario making them to bring coffee to a picnic in the with this cup. But nevertheless, the entire construction of the robot was modified so that it became easier. So it was the evolving design. Any intuition you get from one to implement into the other, this is why we needed two at least trials.
How would you decide which constructive or structural element to insert?
It is the expert opinion of the teacher.
So a human decides?
Yes, it's human, yes. But it's possible to automatize, I mean, to see children, to notice that the child carries around the element and insert it, and it's possible to introduce this logic as well, to automatize. Game clustering. So, after the first experiment, we had a set of data and we wanted to make use of it towards the second trial. And when we evaluated again quantitatively and qualitatively, we clustered the games, 12 games, into three clusters. First, cluster one consisted of games that were almost ready to implement in practice and start selling and start selling and making some big profits out of this. Cluster two were which needed some modification, and cluster three were which needed bigger modification than initially was assumed, that they needed to be reprogrammed or made, or even we replaced the processor to make it faster and so on and so on. So cluster one, for example, cluster one was this walking robot. Also games like Shapes and Curves and Pippa and Jumpido. Now singing and dancing, and this is one of the games of Jupiter called Fun Math. When if they compute correctly, the balloons will disappear. The conclusion regarding this experiment, and this is still under the review and not published yet. This particular results. The proposed system model for evaluation of the process of design of games is an effective instrument in the evolving design of games for children with special needs. This is why we call it evolving. It evolves. And it can take forever, but since our brains are not linear systems, it will probably not make sense to have more than two or three experiments. So switch to another game and test it, and switch to another, test it, and so on and so on. It can be applied to predict the duration of game evolution in quantitative terms. The approach is applicable in other educational domains, so just to design novel instruments. It combines the expert system approach and psychological scaling approach, the expert's opinion gets quantified and used as objective measurement instrument for seemingly non-measurable items, quantities. Other interfaces are my gaze-assisted eye tracker. I am interested in using my gaze. This my gaze is also I put it somewhere. It follows my eyes. It's not intrusive. It's not on my head. Also, it can be used in special education when children what we need to what we want to help the child make use of their gaze. And the future work based on novel human-robot interfaces can be teaching robots express empathy by detecting the cognitive social motivation of the learner, providing smart feedback to children with minimal brain dysfunction to help focus attention, empowering the learner by giving control over the learning process independently of physical or mental condition. Then this is when we give them the interface and do whatever you want, I'm not looking in there. Bridging communication with typically developing children. It is very important because children in those adults, they're in these centers, they go to regular school, and after school they come to the day center to practice some skills. And they showed up, they said, we have a robot. And children from the school said, what? You have a robot? I'll come with you. I want to come and see what the robot is. And they go and play with the robot and help each other. And this is again a way to help those children socialize and feel in the community, in class, feel better. So we observe this. We have these children coming to play with the robot and with their friends to see how the robot performs. So it's wonderful to have a robot at school. And this is very sweet because Dani, she cannot speak. She does not speak, but she's so fond of the robot, and if the robot has three fingers, so she does not know that it's because it has three fingers. So she goes, every time the robot raises its hand, she goes like this, imitating every movement of the robot. And her teacher, although she, because she does not speak, it's not easy to detect the change, but her teacher says that it helped her a lot, and maybe because of the robot, she spoke for the first time in her life. So, thank you very much.
I'd like to thank